All right, so welcome everyone to our OpenSim webinar. My name is Jennifer Hicks. I'm the OpenSim R&D Manager, as well as the Associate Director of the National Center for Stimulation and Rehab Research. I'll be serving as the moderator for today's webinar. I'm pleased to welcome today's presenter, Ed Chadwick, who's a lecturer in the Biomedical Engineering Department at Keele University. He'll be presenting on fast stimulation of arm dynamics for real-time user-in-the-loop control applications. Next slide, please. Before we get started, just a reminder about the goals of the webinar series and the goals of the OpenSim project in general. So OpenSim is a freely available software application for visualizing musculoskeletal structures and simulating movements of humans and animals in the environment. The application includes tools for general purpose inverse dynamics, as well as optimization to estimate muscle and joint forces. Other methods to create simulations for motion capture, and then tools to analyze and visualize the results of the simulation. So the first goal of our webinar series is to showcase this cutting-edge research that's being performed with OpenSim. OpenSim is also a growing community of users. So the second goal of our series is to provide an easy platform for members of the OpenSim community to communicate and collaborate. Next slide. Before we get started, just a couple quick reminders about the format of the webinar. We'll take all of your questions at the end of the presentation using the text-based Q&A panel. If you need any additional technical help, you can also consult the guide on our website. Now I'd like to introduce our speaker. So next slide, please. So Dr. Chadwick is a lecturer in the Biomedical Engineering Department at Keele University. His research focus is on the application of biomechanical modeling and simulation to study of upper limb function. He's interested in a range of neuromuscular disorders, including spinal cord injury and stroke. He's particularly interested in the use of functional electrical stimulation, or FES, for the restoration of function and to help develop FES devices. He serves on the Executive Council of the International Society of Biomechanics. He's also the chair of the International Shoulder Group. Ed has also been very active in the OpenSim community. He's a winner of an Outstanding Researcher Award from the NCFRR. He's also a past workshop participant. Welcome, Ed. Thank you for being part of our webinar series. And with that, I will let you take it away.
Okay, thank you very much, Jen. Thank you for inviting me to take part in this webinar. I hope you can all hear me correctly. So let me just go on to the
volume. Sounds good, Ed.
There we go. Before I start, I'd just like to acknowledge as my co-workers in this work. This work has been done over quite a period of years by various different people, and so I'd like to acknowledge Dimitra Blana, who's also at Keele here with me, and Tom van der Borkert from Cleveland State, Robert Kirsch from Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland. In addition, of course, I'd like to thank the members of the OpenSim community, in particular the project leads, members of the OpenSim team and the developer community, and also to thank the NCSRR for the Outstanding Research Award, some of which work will be presented here today. And finally, to the NIH as well for funding much of the research, in particular through Case Western Reserve University. So as Jen said, today I'm going to talk about fast simulation of arm dynamics for real-time user-in-the-loop control applications. And I'm going to focus quite a bit of the talk on our motivation and background for the work. I'm going to go over the methods that we use to build the model and how we achieve fast and in fact real-time simulation. I'll show some examples of the simulations that we've done, in particular give an example of one of the user-in-the-loop applications as the particular motivation for this approach to simulation. And finally, I'll talk a little bit about our achievements and the limitations and where we hope to go next. So to start off with, why do we want this kind of fast simulation? What are we going to do with that? So the overall goal of our research consortium is really to restore natural control of arm movements in people with high-level spinal cord injury or other types of neuromuscular disorders that cause paralysis. I mentioned other types because one of the examples I'm going to show later on is actually brainstem stroke. there are many different approaches to solving the paralysis problem or facilitating recovery or function in paralysis. Some people have developed robotic exoskeletons, and saw an example of that at the start of the World Cup last week for the lower limb. There's robotic assistive devices, and there's regenerative medicine, of course, which aims to effect an actual repair to the spinal cord. Our particular approach is reanimation of the limb by muscle stimulation, so electrical stimulation of the muscles to generate force in the muscles and create functional movement. Interestingly, this is a topic that's been picked up recently here in the UK by Nesta, and they've issued, as part of the Longitude Prize, they've issued a grand challenge in one of the areas of work is paralysis. If you're based in the UK, you have a chance to vote for which area of research you think the prize should go to, and today's the last chance to do that. So first of all, I'd just like to say a few words about the problem that we're talking about. So paralysis after spinal cord injury. In spinal cord injury, there's an interruption of the command signal from the brain reaching the muscles that control movement. And the muscles themselves may still well be able to produce force, the ones below the level of the injury, but they're not getting the signal from the brain to contract in a coordinated way to produce movement anymore. So if we can provide coordinated stimulation artificially to those muscles and nerves directly, then we can achieve functional movement for a user who's lost voluntary control of those muscles. And our particular focus has been on the upper limb. So I just want to start off by showing you this example of a neuroprosthetic system that we were working on when I was based at Case Western Reserve University some time ago before I moved back to the UK. So in this example, we've got a couple of implanted stimulators here. If I move the mouse, you should be able to see the arrow. So the orange boxes here are implanted stimulators. They're connected to directly to muscles through these epimysial electrodes here, or intramuscular electrodes, and also to the nerves through the green wires and the green electrodes here for activating whole groups of muscles simultaneously. And obviously that gives us access to a lot of channels for electrical stimulation, so we can produce forces in a diverse sets of muscle groups. So if we can activate those muscle groups in a correctly coordinated way, we can achieve functional movement of the upper limb. So in order to do that, there's an external controller here, which takes a command signal from the user, calculates the required muscle activation patterns to generate the movements that we desire. Now the command signal for that external control unit comes from a number of sources. In this example, it comes from EMG electrodes also implanted in the upper limb. So some muscles for a C5 or C6 level injury, for example, may still be under voluntary control, and we can use the EMG signals from those muscles to control the stimulation to the paralyzed muscles to produce a functioning system that facilitates or enables arm movement. Now there's a number of challenges that we have to think about when we're designing a system like that. So each person's requirements and limitations are unique. It depends on exactly the level of injury, what muscles they have available for stimulation, and what can be used for command sources. That level of force available from each muscle obviously varies from person to person, depending on the size of their muscles and so on. So there's a big diverse set of requirements for the device. The control or command issues are significant as well. So voluntary EMG is one option. We could use other things like a brain computer interface or eye tracking, various different things like that. In particular, for people with very high level injuries, they have very limited command sources. How do we deal with that? How do we ensure that the device will be safe? How does the system adapt if the user's characteristics change over time? So for example, their muscles may get stronger through repeated use, or indeed they may fatigue and get weaker through a single session of use over a shorter period of time. So we use model-based design to address these challenges, and I'll talk about some examples of that now. One of our focuses is particularly on natural control of assistive devices. So a range of command interfaces have been used by various groups. So in particular for controlling a wheelchair for somebody with very high level injury, a sip and puff device has been used, so you can control the wheelchair in terms of forward progression or left and right by using a mouse device. Head orientation has been used, and in particular for controlling the movement of the upper limb, where we need to control reach in different directions, we need slightly more sophisticated control interfaces, so head orientation, eye tracking, EMG from voluntary muscles, as I've already mentioned, or brain-computer interfaces. And in particular, the brain-computer interfaces is a sort of emerging area of interest of ours, and in particular for people with very high-level injuries. So I'll come back to that in a minute. The other thing is that we don't want the user, through these command interfaces, to have to specify the activations in all their muscles individually to achieve a movement. Obviously, that's far too low level of control for the user. So we use a combination of higher level controllers to reduce the cognitive burden on the user and allow them to give higher level commands to the interface, to the system, and then have the system perform the movement. So the feed forward controller, for example, identifies the ideal pattern of muscle activations that we need to perform a certain movement. And a feedback controller corrects the perturbations in that movement due to changing external forces, for example, or fatigue in the muscles, or simply due to errors in the feedforward controller, which are inevitable. In addition to positioning the hand in space and allowing for functional tasks to be completed, when we're thinking about the upper limb, we also have to think about what's happening at the shoulder. In particular, we need to ensure that the scapula is stabilized because the scapula provides a stable base for elevation of the arm. So that means that we need to think about activating the muscles around the scapula that stabilize the scapula to prevent this situation shown here, which is scapular winging. In addition, we have to look at the glenohumeral stability. The glenoid is a fairly small surface area on which sits a fairly large humeral head. That joint is not really inherently terribly stable, so we need coordinated contraction or activation of the muscles around the glenohumeral joint, i.e. the rotator cuff muscles, in order to maintain glenohumeral stability during performance of arm reaching tasks or positioning the hand in the workspace and that kind of thing. Most of these things, the scapular stability and the glenohumeral stability, are the responsibility of the external controller in an FPS system, so if we're designing a control system for a functional electrical stimulation system. So as I said, we use model-based design to help us design things like this. So I'll show you an example of that here. So this is a controller that would be used in an FPS system. So we give the controller our desired trajectory or reference trajectory. The feed-forward part of the controller here calculates the desired muscle activations. We can then use a model to assess the effect of that controller, the performance of that controller on achieving the arm trajectories that we were actually looking for. So we've got muscle activations going into this arm model and a trajectory coming out. So you can see from that, that's a forward dynamic model here. That means that our feed-forward controller here is actually an inverse dynamic model because we've got the reference trajectory going in as the input and the muscle activations coming out as the output. So our model is actually used twice here. In determining our ideal controller. In addition to that feed-forward part, we've also got a feedback part which can correct the errors in the trajectory away from our reference trajectory and ensures the stability of the glenohumeral constraints and scapular stability during the movement. Now, if we're looking at upper limb reaching movements, it's not sufficient to just specify a movement and say, or we can design a controller to achieve that movement. The user, sorry, I'll take a drink. Losing my voice slightly. The user is an integral part of that control system, and they will adapt the command signals that they give to the system depending on what the arm does. So if we want to look at the effectiveness of that controller and design an optimal controller for this kind of system, that user needs to be in the control loop as well. So then we've got a scenario like this shown in this figure here. So if, for example, we've got somebody with a high-level injury and we're trying to design a system based around a brain-computer interface, then we need an FES controller here that takes the input from the BCI decoder. So at this point here from the BCI, we've got the movement intent. That goes into the FES controller, which calculates the muscle stimulation patterns required. That can then go into our forward dynamic musculoskeletal model, which simulates the actual motion of the arm and then feeds that back to the user. The user can then modulate the command signal that they're given to the BCI in order to control that arm and perform the task that they're required to complete. So that kind of scenario was really the motivation for having a fast forward dynamic simulation, because obviously for this loop to work correctly, this model has to stimulate the movements of the arm in real time. So that's fed back to the user and allows them to make modifications to their command. So that's the motivation for our work. Now, in order to achieve very fast simulation or real-time simulation, that's quite a challenge in a complex, large-scale musculoskeletal system. If we have a large variation in the time constants within the system, i.e. the rate of response of the outputs or a specified change in the inputs can vary greatly, that's what we call a stiff system in this kind of simulation system. So for example here, we've got the clavicle as a very small thin bone, which means it has a very low moment of inertia, particularly around an axial rotation about its own axis. Very low moment of inertia structure attached to fairly stiff muscles. That leads to very rapid changes in the output for a given change in the input, and that's a stiff system. So that means that when we're trying to perform the simulation, the integrator step sizes have to be very small in order to ensure a stable solution to the simulation. Those very small step sizes mean that we have to take very many steps, and therefore the overall simulation is very slow. So that's our first problem. And the aim of this work really was to develop a comprehensive model of the shoulder and elbow, shoulder and upper limb, that represents muscle dynamics, muscle skeleton coupling, and arm inertial properties, and that runs in real time. So how did we achieve that? Well, we started with a model, the delft shoulder and elbow model, in fact. So we took the parameters from that model, so the details of origins and insertions of the muscles, the muscle properties, the muscle parameters, the details of the joints and the wrapping objects and so on. And we built that in Sim, which was then later converted to OpenSim. So that was our starting point for the model. So this is where we use OpenSim in the pre-processing side of things. That model has 11 degrees of freedom, and that includes a large number of muscle elements that represent the very wide insertions of upper limb muscles. Sorry, I'm losing my voice a little. The joints are represented typically by three degree of freedom orthogonal hinges at the glenohumeral joint, for example, elbow flexion extension, pronation supination, etc. And there are wrapping objects defined for all those muscles that don't have a simple straight line origin to insertion pathway. If we zoom in on the glenohumeral joint here, you can see an example of that. So I've taken out one muscle element and shown it wrapping around geometrical object at the glenohumeral joint at the humerus. So this allows us to calculate, by defining the pathway of the muscle wrapping around the bone, that allows us to calculate the moment arm of that muscle element for every position of the model. Finally, the muscle model itself is a hill-type muscle model, and we used first-order dynamics to represent the activation dynamics of the muscles. So in order to achieve fast simulation, as I said, we've got this problem that we have a stiff system, and a commonly used explicit solver is required to take extremely small step sizes in order to maintain stability of that simulation. So if we have a look at this equation here, this shows an example of a very simple explicit solver where the value of the solution at the following time step is based only on the current time step and an estimation of the slope of the function at the current time step. That means it can very rapidly become unstable if we've got a very steep gradient involved in that kind of simulation. So we have to maintain extremely small step sizes to maintain stability. With an implicit solver shown here, then our estimate is based on estimates of the gradient at the next time step as well, which is a more complicated formulation, but is much more stable. So that increased stability allows us to take much greater step sizes. There is an additional cost to taking those greater steps, but by use of analytical derivatives for the state variables rather than numerical, allows us to minimize the additional cost involved and using that integral, that implicit solver. So ultimately, because we can take steps of orders of magnitude bigger with the implicit solver than we can with the explicit, overall we're much, much faster. Finally, the last thing is that calculating the wrapping of the muscle elements, as I showed in the previous slide, is a fairly time-consuming process as well. So we pre-process the moment arms and the muscle lengths throughout the entire workspace. So we put the model in all possible configurations throughout this entire workspace and calculate the moment arms and the muscle lengths in advance of runtime to speed things up. So in order to do that, I just wanted to show you this example of how we use OpenSim for that as well. This is the we use the OpenSim API for this rather than the graphical user interface. So this is the application programming interface. And that allows us to get moment arms and muscle lengths out of OpenSim programmatically. So we can batch process every single position of the model in the workspace in one go and extract the parameters of muscle length and moment arms. That particular part does take a couple of hours to run, but that's obviously only done once before we actually start simulating the model. Once we've got expressions for or got data on all those muscle lengths throughout the entire workspace, we can model those using polynomials, and then that polynomial evaluation during runtime is much, much faster than calculating the wrapping. And we do that with a maximum error of 10% of the maximum moment arm value or length value or 2 millimeter, whichever is greater. So how do we implement that? So we use autolove to derive the equations of motion. So that allows us to also derive symbolic expressions or analytical derivatives for the states, which, as I said, is essential for speeding up our simulation. Muscle dynamics and their derivatives were implemented using analytical derivatives, but using our own custom C code. We model scapular thoracic contact, i.e. the contact between the scapula and the ellipsoid, that represents the thorax, it's a nonlinear elastic force. This stops the scapula passing into the thorax too far during simulations. And finally, the actual simulations are carried out in MATLAB using the implicit solver, as I mentioned, and we use the first order Rosenbrock method for this. If you want to know more details about that, I'll refer you to the Procedure IUTAM paper from Tom and Bogert, the references I've given at the end for that as well. So this implicit method allows us to take much larger steps than the explicit method does, and our use of analytical derivatives speeds up the calculation of each step as well. So overall, we use OpenSim to do pre-processing, so actually building a model, pre-processing the calculation of moment arms and muscle length. We then do real-time simulation using MATLAB. And finally, we do some visualization in OpenSim, and I'll show you some examples of that in a minute. So if we have a look at some results, the first thing I want to show you is this example of a forward flexion movement of the arm, which is supposed to be on repeat. There it goes again. Okay. So our first evaluation criterion for the model was, is it fast enough? Obviously, it has to be real time. So that means that if we can simulate 4 seconds of movement, as we did in this case, in less than 4 seconds, then that's good enough. So in this case, it was 3.5. And that was on fairly standard computer. It was an Core i5 Pentium laptop, so a couple of years old as well, actually. So in this case, we calculated the inputs for this forward dynamic model, i.e. the muscle activations, by using an inverse dynamics simulation, where we carried out static optimization of the muscle forces and estimated muscle activities from that. We put those back into the forward dynamic model. It reproduces a similar movement, and it does that in real time. So we can see that from this animation here on the right. The figure on the left allows us to look at the angles somewhat of the actual elevation. But in particular, I wanted to point out this oval in the bottom panel down here, which is a projection of the glenoid. And the line inside the glenoid here shows the intersection points of the reaction force vector from the humeral head on the glenoid surface. So that is used as a proxy measure of glenohumeral joint stability. when that reaction force vector moves towards the edge of the gonoid, we're approaching the limit of stability of the gonoid neural tract. But we wanted a different way to visualize that, and so we created the plugin for OpenSim, and this is one of the things we did at the Advanced User Workshop in Stanford last year. So let me just show you that one. I'll stop this one so it doesn't distract. So on the picture on the left now, the animation on the left, we can see a visualization of the reaction force vector. So the direction of the line and the coloring of the line indicates the stability of that reaction force. As the line is red, it's less stable, and as it goes more green, it's more centered in the gonoid, and therefore shows a more stable joint. The length of the line is also proportional to the force there as well. So in this particular simulation, what I've done there is simply to generate a set of muscle activations artificially that will produce an approximate abduction of the arm to see how we could visualize the differences. So at the start of the abduction, I've applied activations to the deltoid muscle to generate abduction of the arm, but without pre-activating the rotator cuff to stabilize the joint. And that's why that line goes red at the beginning of the elevation there. Once we start to elevate a bit more, I've then turned on or increased the activation in the rotator cuff. You can see the line suddenly becomes much more green and it's much more stable. So that's quite a nice way that we can visualize anything, the stability, and sort of play around with the effects of different muscles and see how they affect stability of the joint. So the next thing to look at after model performance is to see what the behavior is like. How closely does the model match data from the literature in terms of its behavior? So what we did here was to do some simulations where we maximized the isometric joint moments around each degree of freedom in each direction and compared those values from the literature for the arm in various different positions. So on the left, you can see plots of shoulder abduction on the top, shoulder flexion extension on the bottom. And the solid black lines represent our model simulation results. And the red lines of varying types show the data from the literature. So we can see in abduction in particular, and shoulder flexion, also forearm pronation and elbow flexion, our model estimated maximal isometric joint moments throughout the range of motion fall within the range of measured values reported in the literature. So they're reasonably well with what's reported. But one or two of the others, in particular adduction here and shoulder extension here, there's throughout some parts of the range there's a bit of discrepancy. In fact, our model is tending to overestimate shoulder adduction moments and underestimate shoulder flexion. Shoulder extension moments. It's worth noting that there's only one set of data in the literature on this, so we've got no idea what the spread of that is. That wasn't reported. And of course, we didn't scale the model to match any individual subjects either, so we might not expect a perfect agreement for that. Last example I want to talk about is what motivated us in the first place, which was the ability to do user-in-the-loop simulations. So in this case, we used our real-time model in a virtual reality environment, and we wanted to assess the potential of somebody with complete paralysis to control a nonlinear dynamic system, such as an arm implanted with an FES system that would restore movement through stimulating the muscles. So in order to do this, we worked with a participant who had had more than 10 years previously. She'd had a brainstem stroke, had locked-in syndrome. And she was a user of a brain gate, brain computer interface. So this is an implanted electrode array in the motor cortex that records her activity during intended movements. She had established control of kinematic systems, such as a computer mouse, using the BCI system, but had never attempted control of a dynamic system. So we used a simplified model of the dynamic arm simulator to assess her ability to do that. This was an earlier version than the version I'm presenting today, because it only allowed planar movement rather than 3D movement of the limb. So our goal here was to answer the question, how well can this user control a dynamic, nonlinear system representing arm dynamics? This shows a schematic of the setup. This is the participant with the implanted 96-channel intracortical array called BrainGate. recorded neuronal activity from that. We did this in collaboration with Brown University, and they were responsible for this part of the system over here, so the spike sorting and decoding. Out of that came the movement command in terms of hand endpoint velocity. That went into the FES controller, which estimated the muscle activations required to achieve that movement. We then simulated that movement using the forward dynamic musculoskeletal model and presented the results of that simulation back to the user. We then modulated their brain activity in order to try and achieve control of the arm. So I can show you a little video of the results of that. So the person is presented with targets on the screen appearing at random locations and of varying size. And she has to control the arm to reach the target using the brain-computer interface. When the arm is over the target, she then imagines making a fist-pointing maneuver, and that activates a state change, which drives the click of the finger to touch the target and reach the target. So she was able to do that fairly well. So she was able to have control of this dynamic nonlinear system, even after more than 10 years of arm non-use. And importantly, she was able to learn to do that simply by thinking about arm movement. So the training of the decoder was done by thinking about arm movement rather than any more or less related proxy activity. So it was quite a natural control that she had. Okay, so just to finish off then, so what we've seen from the what we found and what I've shown you today is that we're able to achieve simulation of the system faster than real time. And I should reiterate at this point that although in the user in the loop example there I showed you an older model, we've now generated the full three-dimensional model with a mobile controllable scapula and clavicle and so on, and that's in the publication that's just come out, which I'll refer to at the end as well. We got better than real-time performance on fairly normal computer hardware. It's a Core i5 laptop. So there's a lot of scope for improving the performance there by using faster, newer processors as well. There was enough additional time in the simulation loop after we calculated the integration to calculate additional output parameters, such as the glenohumeral joint stability. That allowed us to monitor the stability in real time during the simulation, as well as to produce additional visualizations. So if we integrate this model with a virtual reality platform, as I've shown you in that example, that gives us a total platform, which is quite a powerful system for allowing virtual device development. So we can investigate the potential of the participant to learn to carry out complex dynamic tasks, as I've shown you. We can use that simulation and virtual reality platform to optimize the design of the device. For example, we might want to optimize the location and the number of stimulation channels. We can use it to develop and test controllers for feed-forward and feedback controllers, looking at different command sources, so one for EMG or brain-computer interfaces and so on, as I said. There are still some limitations, of course. We saw a little bit of lack of agreement in the moment angle curve between the model and the published data. As I said, the model is based on cadaver data, and it's not scaled to match individual participants, so we might expect to see some differences there. That's something we need to work on. And of course, we're approximating the moment arms throughout the workspace using polynomials rather than calculating the exact wrapping in real time during the simulation as you would normally do if you're using OpenSim for forward dynamic simulations. The model is a mechanical representation of the musculoskeletal system and represents some dynamic aspects of model of muscle force generation, for example, so the muscle activation dynamics are included and so on. But neurological components such as muscle spindles and that level of feedback is not really there at the moment. So there's a bit of some data missing from the model probably, which again is typical of all of this type of musculoskeletal model. You may have noticed that there isn't a proper hand. There's a kinematically controlled hand at the moment, so we are working on creating a hand controlled by muscles as well. And finally, there's the difficulty of validation, which is common to all musculoskeletal models, really, in that we can only sort of verify the performance in terms of fairly high-level behavior But really, we'd like to actually measure the muscle forces throughout the system to validate properly, but we can't really do that. So our next steps, we'd like to integrate more tightly with OpenSim, both at the front end and at the post-processing end. So in terms of model building, we'd like to allow easier modification and customization of the models, and quicker and easier sort of one-touch conversion to real-time format. And we'd like to achieve improved visualization of the results as well. So as I said, we've been working on various ways of visualizing the results by driving a virtual reality environment or by the force vector plugin that I showed you as well. That still needs a little bit of work in terms of debugging at the moment. We'd like to extend the model to include neuromuscular components so that we can model a wider range of pathologies than we can at the moment. And we'd like to add the capability to interact with the environment. So by adding a hand and a contact model so that we can use the device to sort of test and try out interactions such as picking up objects and pushing things and so on. There's a few key publications I'd like to mention. The first one here is the one that's actually just come out. Actually, I've still got Impress on here, but 2 days ago it got a volume number, so that one is now for sure. So you can download that one and have a look at it. I'll put these on the SimTK project page for the model as well. This one, the 2011 paper, describes the user in the loop simulation that I showed you with the brain gate user. The bottom one here from Van der Bovet et al. 2011 describes the more of the numerical methods and the methodology for performing the simulations. We put some things on SimTK for you to download and play with. One of those is this MATLAB GUI, so you can download the real-time model and you can try out the OpenSim visualizer. So this is a MATLAB graphical user interface panel here that has some sliders on it that allow you to control muscle groups. If you start that off, the model will start simulating, and you can try and control the shoulder by increasing or decreasing the activation in various muscle groups. If anybody can make the model take a drink, for example, successfully without the use of an artificial controller, I'll be very impressed. It's really quite hard to control. So if you want to find out any more information about this model, you want to download things and have a play around or give us some feedback or hopefully contribute some changes, then you can find the project on SimTK at this location. You can find a little bit more information from our university web pages. So we've continued the development of this 3D model since coming back to the UK here. And some information on our we have group pages here. We have a Google Plus page as well now. You can find additional information about our colleagues, Bob Kirsch and Tom van der Berg, at their respective institutional pages. Thank you very much for listening.
For those interested, we'll send out a follow-up email that has some of these links to the materials that Ed mentioned at the end. It's great that you have a SimTK project where you're sharing the model. So with that, we can get started with the Q&A session. Can you bring up the next slide for me, Ed? So as I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, all of our questions will be text-based. What you need to do is go to the Q&A panel, type your question in the box, and make sure you select all panelists before you send in your question. So that's pretty easy. Hopefully you guys have some questions for Ed. Go ahead and type your questions. Get those in.
While you're typing any questions, I'd just like to apologize for my voice. I'm suffering quite a lot of brain fever, and it's kind of losing my voice a bit. You can hear me coughing. I'm sorry about that.
The webinar format is hard, but I could hear you fine, so hopefully everybody else could as well. While we're waiting for the questions to come in, I have a couple. So my first question is about the case study. The results you got for the one subject were really impressive. I was wondering how the results you presented compare to other brain-computer interface systems that don't use an upper extremity model, and you're just the user is typically just trying to move a cursor.
I think in terms of the performance of the BCI, when the user is performing kinematic tasks, the performance is really quite comparable. I don't think anybody else has really done something that we can compare with in this way, because nobody's tested an actual FES system, and nobody else has tested this kind of virtual FES system, I don't think. Mm-hmm. What other people have tended to do is to control external devices more, I think. So you may have seen there was a Nature publication last year with the same participant, actually, where they got her to control an external robotic arm to assist her with drinking and feeding.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's quite hard to compare the results directly. If we look at the differences between her control of the dynamic system and her control of the kinematic system, then there was essentially no difference. She was, that's the form of the result that we present in the paper, really, is that she was just as good at controlling the dynamic system as she was at controlling the kinematic only system.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, the speed of movement that she made with the dynamic system, as you can see there, was quite slow. And that's really a choice of ours as much as anything else, in that we, there's a trade-off between her speed of movement and the accuracy. And so we had, we made the controller such that her movements were quite slow, so that she could achieve the accuracy rather than overshooting a lot all the time.
Okay, great, thanks. That's true that others haven't used an FES system. I guess I was curious if it might be easier to, even in a virtual environment, if it would be any easier to learn to use a system where movement is based on pre-existing physiology.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that experiment has been done yet, actually.
Yeah.
I think if you're controlling an external device, like a robotic arm, then that robotic arm has its own controllers built in, which are essentially extremely good, and effectively you're controlling it as a kinematically controlled device, although it has a lot of dynamics. Those are really hidden from you as the user.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you. So now we have a question from Anton Tulipov. He says, thank you for the presentation. And his question is there a conflict between the need to pre-process muscle wrapping and the fact that the user's muscles are likely to change and develop during FES use?
There is, in the sense that it makes it slightly harder to modify the model. I mean, if you were doing a sort of long-term study and you were using OpenSim to model things, then you could periodically take measurements from the user and use that to update your model. Now we can still do that as well, but then we do have to go through this extra step of pre-processing, which is a bit more labor intensive.
Mm-hmm.
Does that answer the question?
Yeah, I think that answers the question. So user or participants, go ahead and type your questions in. While I'm waiting for more user questions, I have another one. So you've suggested a few different areas about things you're going to pursue next. Are there other key sort of application studies you're planning, or what do you think is the most important model improvement that you'd like to include in the model?
I think there's two really big areas for model development that we need to do, and this applies to lots of other people's models as well as our own, and that is the neuromuscular or the neurological aspects.
Mm-hmm.
As I said, the models really represent mechanical relationship between muscle force and movement, and there's some incorporation of physiology in the sense that muscle violence is incorporated, but there's no feedback mechanism to, for example, stabilize the movement at all. There's no muscle spindle activity or anything like that, or Golgi tendon. So I think that would be something that would be really interesting to try and add. I know it's a big task, mm-hmm. because that would allow us to do a lot more in terms of applications and understanding pathology. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is customization of the model in terms of the parameters that we have measured to individual users. As I said, we haven't scaled our model to represent an individual user, which obviously leads to significant differences between its behavior and what we actually observe people. I know that there is facility within OpenSim to do some kind of scaling, but the question is, what kind of scaling do you need to do? If you just scale the bones, for example, what do you then do with all the muscle parameters? Well, you can scale some of them, but perhaps not all of them. So it's difficult to maintain the integrity of the model. But I think a lot more work needs to be done on how we actually customize the model to represent an individual. Not only how you do the scaling, but how do you get the parameters as well, obviously from in vivo.
Right. I mean, OpenSim scaling algorithm has been used more often with lower extremity model scaling. So just figuring out what the differences are and how to do it in the upper extremity will be really important. I agree.
And I think in particular at the scapula. Now, if you've got a long bone like the tibia, for example, it may be a little bit more straightforward to see how you can scale it according to length or the width between the condyles and so on. But with the scapula, which is really not a linear structure at all,
mm-hmm.
I'm not quite sure where you start with that.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks. We have another question from the audience. This question is from Jacob Siegel. When applied to the control of a prosthetic arm, the number of control inputs, that's EMG sites, could be minimized in a clinical setting. How will the model behave with only a small number, say 4, of volitional EMG control signals?
Well, what we've done with our controller is to indeed reduce the number of inputs required to control it. So if you had 4 inputs, for example, you can control endpoint velocity or endpoint position of the hand, and then the FES controller takes care of working out what to do with the individual degrees of freedom of all the joints and all the muscle forces. So the user only has to give a much lower level or higher level command. There has been some work done on looking at how you control X number of degrees of freedom with some number much less than X, and that was published by Andy Cornwell, I think, a couple of years ago. I can't remember the exact numbers, but they showed that they were able to control something like 80% of the tasks that they wanted to do as a set of activities that they were living with only, I think, 4 degrees of freedom. I can't remember the exact numbers, but something of that order.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. Audience members, we still have time for a couple more questions, so go ahead and get those questions in. While we're waiting, I have another question. This one is about your SimTPlay.org project. Mm-hmm. It's great that you've shared the model and the MATLAB code. And it sounds like a user can open up the model and move the sliders around by hand to try to generate some coordinated movement. Are there other ways that someone could input either a pre-computed control signal or write their own controller?
Yes, so what we've supplied in the package, in fact I made that public this morning, so you can go and have a look at that
right now.
What we supplied in that package is the executable, which is the real-time model, which is a MATLAB next function. There's some MATLAB scripts that work with that and in fact control the stepping through the simulation. There's a couple of higher order scripts that allow you to specify inputs and control of simulation. And then there's obviously the GUI as well. I don't think the code for the optimization is in there yet, is it? With the next release, probably, we're going to add the code that will do the moment optimization that I mentioned as well. But at the moment, you can certainly specify your own inputs, and there's sort of MATLAB templates in there, I think, that allow you to do that. So you can control it from, you can run simulations either from pre-calculated inputs that you obtain from some means, or you could even connect it up to hardware and you could control it using a set of EMG signals, for example, or any other hardware device. That's really the main use of it, is controlling it directly in hardware with the user and seeing how the user responds.
Okay, great. That sounds really cool. I'll have to check it out after the webinar.
Yeah, and we've got the bug tracking and feature request things alive there, as well as a forum and various ways to get in touch with us as well. So if anybody has questions or suggestions or improvements, then obviously we'd love to hear about those.
Okay, great. And as I mentioned earlier, you'll get a follow-up email, and we'll make sure that it has a link to the SimCK project so everyone can find it. So I think those are all the questions, so I'll go ahead and close the Q&A session. Can you move to the next slide for me, Ed?
Mm-hmm.
We already did all the questions.
Next one again, is it?
Yeah. So I do want to acknowledge that OpenSim and this webinar series are supported by several grants. These are grants from the NIH, including one that funds our National Center for Simulation and Rehab Research. We're also supported by the DARPA Warrior Web effort. Next slide. I want to thank you, Ed, again for a great talk, and thanks to the audience for their great questions. You can find information about the NCSRR and the OpenSim project, upcoming events, and other resources for the OpenSim community on our website. You'll get a survey that will appear in a pop-up window at the conclusion of the webinar. Please fill this out and help us improve the webinar series and choose upcoming topics. Thank you, everyone, for participating. We hope you will continue to stay involved with OpenSim. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.